Saint-Jacques earned a degree in engineering, working in the field for 2 years before going back to school for a PhD in astrophysics. After that, he worked at some of the world's top facilities, but then, still in his 30s, another career called to him. He went to medical school, choosing to practice in the far north in a small Inuit community on the eastern shore of Hudson's Bay. In between climbing mountains and sailing oceans, Saint-Jacques also got his commercial pilot's license. By the way, he speaks 5 languages.
I also feel humbled by this because I know it's, the task that lies ahead is huge.
And when he was selected by Canada's space program, he still hadn't hit 40. The years since have been spent training for what is likely to be the greatest adventure of his life. I got a chance to see that process up close at the Johnson Space Center in Houston. The making of an astronaut.
All right, you ready for this?
Yes, sir, we're ready for you.
What an illustration of just how complex and challenging astronaut training is. Well, take a look at NASA's Neutral Buoyancy Laboratory, where going underwater helps prepare David Saint-Jacques for going into space. Just getting dressed is cumbersome. This already bulky suit will stiffen when it's pressurized. And when he goes underwater to work on a life-size replica of the International Space Station, every move he makes will be watched and assessed by a team of scientists.
Everyone, helmets are
on the line. Copy that, no alarm.
All these training sessions, they represent things that I must know and I must master, not to try to please an instructor or to pass a test, but I must know them if I want to survive. And so that added sense of reality, of urgency, of this kind of animal fear is what drives me to really focus.
Okay, so I have stowed the new DDCU to the cedar cart.
All right, David, welcome to Argos. We are the active response gravity offload system, and it's gonna simulate zero gravity for you. So go through our various mock-ups here, do some electrical repair work for the station, get you a full hour in the system.
Very good.
Preparation for space goes from underwater to midair. Argos is not as simple as it may look. Those harnesses are connected to sensors that come very close, we're told, to matching the challenge of weightlessness on the ISS.
It's a strange feeling because it's a feeling that your body is not used to. We're always used to having gravity or a wall or the floor to push against, counteract against. One of the things about spaceflight is the absence of that. You are floating around, but you're not floating in water. We can train in water, but in water you can cheat, you can swim. So we train on Argos to learn that, to learn the art. For example, I'm holding on with both hands. Before I release one hand, I better make sure I have no rotation going. Because if I push and then release and push, I'm just gonna keep spinning. And maybe my wrist is too weak to fight that, so I'm gonna be flailing back, right? So you learn that by mistake.
So you're better now than you were when you first did it?
Yes, 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 yes. And everybody says on board that's, you know, there's always a senior crew and they've been there for a month, and then when the rookies come in, they're bouncing all over the place. They're constantly crashing in the walls because they can't really fly well. So there's a learning curve to it.
Great, job well done.
Set.
You're good to go, dude.
It takes an unusual array of skills to make the grade here. The physical ability to adapt to near zero gravity and withstand the G-forces of blast-off and the return to Earth. The stamina to work out about 2 hours a day on the ISS to try to maintain muscle and bone mass. But in an instant, survival in space can require much more than just brawn.
We look for the decrease in some chemical that
OPI.
Eats
ice. Very good. Excellent.
Perhaps it's like being back in medical school, constantly being tested. Here, Saint-Jacques is quizzed about which pipe does what. So many acronyms, even the instructor gets mixed up.
This one works on the MTL.
On the MTL?
No.
Okay. It's LTL.
I'm sorry, LTL.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yep.
Those details could be critical. Among his duties on the International Space Station, Saint-Jacques will be responsible for maintenance on the Columbus lab and conducting experiments on astronaut health in the Destiny and Unity labs, as well as controlling the Canadarm.
Going back to PMA, gas is 41.
Replicated in training in this virtual reality lab.
I was in the zone. Mm-hmm. And, you know, all this virtual training that we do, space flight is one of those things you cannot train for real. You have to fake it. You have to play astronaut all the time. And it only works if you make an effort to believe in it.
Ready or ready?
If you make an effort to put yourself there and you say, today, I am really in the cupola, in space station, really about to capture a spacecraft worth several hundreds of millions of dollars, and with the whole world watching, I must not screw this up.
Anything make you nervous or anxious now?
You always have this this tension that you're being evaluated, and that kind of fades away after years. But the self-imposed tension that this may be my last chance to train this, this may be the last time I have an instructor available to answer this question on this topic, there's a sense of urgency, and the nearer and nearer you get to the launch, the more and more responsible you feel for your own training, and the more and more you realize that at the end of the day, it's just between you and yourself, whether you're really ready.
Ready for this November, just over 7 months from now. The Russians now provide transport to the International Space Station, and Saint-Jacques has been training to co-pilot the Soyuz launch from Kazakhstan alongside Russian cosmonaut Oleg Kononenko. American astronaut Anne McLean is the third member of this mission.
Does that mean you're going to be the mediator up there?
interesting question. Between us, the crew, astronauts, cosmonauts from different countries, we're like brothers and sisters in arms. We really feel fortunate that we are above the earthly fights.
Even right now, because, I mean, you can't help but look at the headlines and see the tensions between Russia and the United States. Does any of that seep into your world at all?
We are in lockstep, yeah. And it is one of the beauties of the space program. To me, it's one of the things I'm most proud of, to be part of one of those areas of human endeavor where we actually honestly want to work together, achieving a common goal.
Is there anything in your life up until now, and you've had this such an accomplished background, but is there anything in particular that more than anything prepared you for this moment?
No, it's interesting. So looking back, I think it all contributed to some extent. Certainly dealing with medical emergencies, maybe from a psychological perspective, was pretty near to that. But then working as an astrophysicist on very expensive equipment, doing repairs there, you also get a sense of acute sense of responsibility. You don't want to mess that up. And then, you know, perhaps living as a married man with children, you learn a lot about teamwork. You learn a lot about feeling out for other people's emotions. And at the end of the day, I think we see it from experience. The vast majority of problems people ever have in space flights are based on human relationships and communication. So you have to feel ready for that aspect. You're not just there to push buttons.
It has been 2 years of mastering his skills in Europe, Russia, Japan, and of course, in the US.
There's the incredible miracle of international collaboration that it represents, especially this day and age. You should never forget that the space station was built by 16 nations, the four biggest contributors being the United States, Russia, Germany, and Japan. And you don't have to look back long to go back to an era where there was very little collaboration between these four nations. So space does that. It is one of those arenas where humans play well together and honestly want to achieve the same goal. And that is, I think as Canadians, a bit like that. Canada is one of those countries that tries to settle conflicts, right, as opposed to create them. So I think this means something for me.
I really like him, but also I'm very deeply jealous of you, because that must have been an amazing experience. Tell me more about your impressions of him.
Well, let's revisit one of the things he said. So astrophysicist, commercial pilot, doctor, but what did he say has maybe got him best prepared for being in space? it's being a spouse and a parent.
Yeah.
And what
yeah.
that's taught him about working with people, we can relate to that. And maybe it's the only thing we can relate to with him. But it was pretty impressive.
Yeah, I don't have to work up 2 hours a day for this job. the last time they opened up the recruitment in this country for astronauts, more than 3,700 Canadians applied. They chose two. So wow. people want that job. Not me, but other people do.